The city awakes to the bells of Notre Dame. The fisherman fishes, the bakerman bakes, to the bells of Notre Dame. To the big bells as loud as the thunder, to the little bells soft as a psalm. And some say the soul of the city is the toll of the bells. The bells of the
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of the Game Changer Podcast. I am Nate the Effing Great, and for those of you that probably are not too familiar with the music that is playing here, it is one of the songs, one of the many songs from a bit of an interesting movie that was created by Disney, known as The Hunchback of Notre Dame. To be honest, I'm going to talk a little bit about it and also give a little bit of input on what I would like to see in The Hunchback of Notre Dame live action remake. Normally I do like a fantasy booking or a rewrite of something like that, but this is going to be more just pitching ideas on what I would really like to see in the movie series. So I will say this, that I was not too familiar with Victor Hugo's version of The Hunchback of Notre Dame until I actually got the chance to read the plot and kind of understand the characters and everything like that. And I will say this, that the Victor Hugo one is definitely a lot darker than I thought it was going to be. I mean, it's one of those deals that really addresses, you know, religion and lust and sexual overtone, such like that. It's really one of those things that just absolutely is amazing that something created by that would turn out to be a moderate success, if I am not mistaken. I mean, it got a 71% on Rotten Tomatoes into the Disney version of Hunchback of Notre Dame, which was released in 1996. The story was definitely a lot more simplified, and it was definitely a lot more kid-oriented, but it still had some of those dark overtones that made it different from a lot of movies that had come out in previous years. I mean, you still got that huge, you know, religious presence there. You had a little bit of lust involved in there. Oh my gosh, there was so many dark overtones in there that now that I got the chance to rewatch it, I was just amazed that, you know, as a kid, it didn't affect me too much. But obviously nowadays, people who would watch that would probably be like, oh no, this is just too much for people. And that's something that's really interesting, because the common criticism that a lot of people seem to be having is that I'm okay with the film, but I don't think another person would like it, or somebody else would not like it. And to be honest, it's one of those things where it's like, it's an okay movie. It could be a good movie at points. I mean, some of the dramatic backgrounds are great. The songs can be, honestly, hit and miss when it comes to it. There's a lot of spots where there's comedy, where there probably should not be. I'm going to get into that in a little bit. The characters are pretty developed, honestly. And the main ones have been Frollo, Quasimodo, Phoebus, and Esmeralda, the top four in there. And to be honest, they're kind of fleshed out kind of nicely. You have Esmeralda, who's playing a gypsy who is just trying to make it by in life, but she's caught up in this huge battle in religion that Judge Claude Frollo has created between you know, what he represents with the cathedral and the gypsies. You have Phoebus, who's kind of the little bit of comic relief, but he's also kind of the eye candy for Esmeralda. You have Judge Claude Frollo, like we said, he's basically the one who's heading up a lot of the religious beliefs in this entire movie, and he's going off of those traditions, but he's also kind of twisting it a little bit so that the narrative kind of works in his favor. He's definitely very, very vindictive and very manipulative. To be honest, that's one of the reasons why he is one of the darkest, if not one of the best, Disney villains that they've ever created. And then, of course, there's the main character, Quasimodo, who basically, in this movie, is kind of an ugly duckling kind of story written around him, where he doesn't think that he is the, you know, that he's a hideous beast, that everybody would hate him, that everybody would see him as a monster. And as time went on, he realizes that, you know, he was not the monster, that it was always his, you know, quote unquote master, Judge Claude Frollo. And there were some pretty good moments in this movie. I mean, the final battle sequence between Frollo and Quasimodo is honestly absolutely amazing. Just the dark overtones that they had in the background, Quasimodo just leaping from one pillar to another trying to escape Frollo's sword, and that final, oh, that final image of Frollo just having his eyes a fiery glow and just absolutely, you know, almost like it's like he's embracing the devil in the end of it. It's just so well done. Absolutely wonderful. The songs, like I said, can be hit and miss. I know that everybody loves Hellfire. That's Tony J, who is by far one of the best voice actors that I could have ever known. And I am one of those guys who loves, you know, Tim Curry, loves Jim Cummings. Those guys are absolutely amazing. But when you look at somebody like Tony J and some of the roles that he's played, he just knows how to enter, he just knows how to create this presence about him and make his, you know, tone very soft but also very intimidating. It's just absolutely phenomenal hearing that. Like I said, Hellfire is one of the best songs and one of the most memorable songs of the entire movie. And again, it's due to the graphics that are on there, the presentation that's on there, and Tony J's performance with that. It's one of the best songs in Disney movie history, in all honesty. I'm willing to put money on that. Would it be within top 10? I would go that far. Would it be top 5? Maybe, maybe not. I would definitely stick it in the top 10, at least. That might have to be another future podcast that I do. But then we go into some of the rough parts about it. And I think it's just, you know, there's some character developments that's been rushed. There's been some moments on there that just did not need to be there. There's extra characters on there that are just kind of there for the sake of being there. And then we have the gargoyles, which people can definitely have, you know, a 50-50 mindset when it comes to them. They're there for the comic relief. They're also there to kind of guide Quasimodo, per se. But there can also be times where there's kind of in the way, more or less. And the thing to really consider is that, you know, all three voice actors who play these gargoyles are tremendous people, including Jason Alexander. It's just, I think that they were appearing so much and their presence were just kind of weird, to be honest, because I think there's a lot of people that really believe that had they just been that, maybe just a figment of Quasimodo's imagination and not quote-unquote real, then it would have probably been more, I guess you could say, effective or something more interesting to the story. So that is honestly the thoughts that I've heard, and as well as like the criticisms I've heard with the movie. Overall, it's not one of those movies that I'm in a rush to watch every single day, but every now and then if I want to see something that's different and something that kind of reminds you that, hey, it's okay to be different, there are people that are going to, you know, embrace you for who you are, that's kind of the movie that I get out of this. I mean, you'll get a couple of chuckles, you'll get a couple of nice songs here and there, with the best song being, of course, Hellfire. You'll get one of the best villains in all of Disney's history, and you're going to have a darker overtone than what you would get from Disney, because they normally are more aimed towards the family and children orientation. But this was one that was definitely more family-based and probably more towards the more towards a bit of the adult demographic, to be honest. So with that being said, and with them doing all these remakes, which 9 times out of 10 can be a fail, I know from experience, I've known from watching them. The question is, what do I want when it comes to the Hunchback of Notre Dame live action remake? What is something that I really want to take away from this movie? What is something that I would want added to it? Because I think that's what some people really want. They don't want just a simple copy paste and make tiny tweaks from it. They want something that's going to be absolutely you know, more different than what you would expect from it. So like I said, this could go into a full rewrite. It could be me just going from like beginning to end of what I would expect from it. But I kind of narrowed it down to some of the finer details that I really would like for them to have as far as the story goes for the live action remake. So here's the thing about it. Do I agree with them, you know, basically going into the Victor Hugo version and making that into a big screen deal? Not necessarily. I think that there's a couple of very dark overtones on there that just would not really sit well with me. I mean, there's literally a scene where Esmeralda gets hanged, and then there's another scene where Quasimodo ends up, you know, dying next to Esmeralda's corpse. It's just, it's a really, really dark novel when you look into it. But I will say that there are still some things on there that I would probably want to have put into the movie, where honestly the main four should still be, you know, Judge Quad, Frollo, Phoebus, Esmeralda, and Quasimodo. But the thing is, building up that love triangle between Phoebus, Esmeralda, and Quasimodo would be something that I would honestly like to see. Because in the original, you kind of had a feeling that maybe Esmeralda was building up feelings for Quasimodo, but in the end, Phoebus just kind of comes out of nowhere and just takes her heart away. Just, it's really weird when you kind of look at that. So I think, in all honesty, I would love to see more development between these three characters, and really more of a development between the relationship between these three characters. So you can have a couple of the spots in the movie where, you know, you see Esmeralda and Phoebus kind of, you know, talking, and they're kind of bonding a bit, but also have those same kind of scenes with Quasimodo and Esmeralda. And that kind of goes into another point here. Definitely have Frollo's presence have a bigger impact on the movie. Now, what do I mean by that? So, as I mentioned before, Frollo is somebody who is very manipulative, and he's just somebody who knows how to play his words right so it makes sense to other people. So what I am saying is that definitely how they have it in the movie, you have Quasimodo definitely having moments where he's more obedient towards, you know, Frollo. And same thing could be said about Phoebus. At first, Phoebus is just, you know, he's a captain of a guard. He's just doing his job. And at first, he's kind of just thinking, okay, you know, this is kind of part of the job, and this is the stuff that I kind of signed up for. But as time goes on, he definitely, like in the movie, he sees that Frollo is doing these things more in his favor than more of the people's favor. And that's something that Phoebus definitely needs to really have in the movie, is he's somebody who's there to protect the people, never to harm innocent lives. You build that up, you're going to really have a very likable character in Phoebus. And the fact that he is a strong-willed and very strong-minded individual, it's going to make it even more interesting. Now, for Quasimodo, it's going to be a little bit harder to do, because in all honesty, I would still keep the whole deal where Quasimodo loses his mother at the beginning. I honestly will say this, that scene at the beginning is one of the darkest, but also one of the best scenes in Disney's history. It's just so, so out there that you were not thinking that Disney would go that far, to where it looks like the baby is going to get dropped in a well. It's one of those things that it does make this movie different from a lot of the rest. I mean, you see murder in a couple of movies, but you never really see something that dark in a lot of the Disney movies. So keeping that scene in there, but also keeping that story and narrative in there, really helps build the character of Quasimodo, that he has been manipulated longer than Phoebus has. So Phoebus has a chance to, you know, snap right out of it. Quasimodo, on the other hand, does not get that opportunity. Now, this is something else that would develop in the story between Esmeralda and Quasimodo. I would not have that, you know, relationship just kind of build off in like one night like they did in the animated movie. I would have to give it a couple of days, maybe a week at most, because Quasimodo, he has in his mind from Frollo that all gypsies are evil. So he's not quite convinced that when he was released in the, you know, Festival of Fools, that, you know, Esmeralda was doing it for just to be nice to him. He was maybe doing it so that she can get something out of it. And that's also something that I thought at first would be kind of interesting, to have Esmeralda have not so much of the perfect, you know, what's the word looking for that? Mary Sue kind of feel to her. Because it felt like she did no wrong. She was kind of like the perfect, you know, badass person. Which, in all honesty, I will say that she did a lot more than a lot of other princesses did in that time. So I'm just stating that fact, that she definitely is one of those women who is very strong and independent. And she didn't need to be a damsel in distress, except maybe towards the end. But that's different. Anyway, so having, you know, Esmeralda and Quasimodo build that relationship up, and it's one of those times where you can definitely have that kind of, you know, feeling torn between the two. Like, do you want to see Quasimodo and Esmeralda be together? Do you want to see Phoebus and Esmeralda end up together? It's one of those things that I think there has not really been a movie that really questions the mind that well. And I think that they could do an absolutely amazing job if they build up the right kind of, you know, built up between the two of the, between the three of them, and give it a little bit more time. You can still have a little bit of the Stockholm syndrome effect on Esmeralda, but she also sees that there's something different to Quasimodo than meets the eye, of course. So building up the relationship there, definitely, definitely keep Frollo the way he is. Definitely make him a guy who literally is doing what he knows is right, but also as time goes on, he's doing it because this is what he wants. He's been doing something, he's doing everything for everybody else for the longest time. Now he's thinking, I want something out of this. I want, you know, the woman. And again, it's going to make for just a stronger impact going into, you know, further scenes, because you're going to see this as a despicable man. You don't even need to have him have like a backstory behind it. You just have him literally be one of those guys who, again, he gets corrupted during this whole deal. He thinks he's doing it for the church. He's doing it for the cathedral. He's doing it for the church. But in the end, you're realizing that he's now thinking he wants something for himself. He's human. You don't need to have like a tragic backstory behind that to prove that. You just need to have the right motivation for it. Now we go into the songs. Would I change really anything about them? Well, no, not exactly. Maybe there could be a song like duet style between Quasimodo and Esmeralda. I think they expanded more on the song of, you know, God Help the Outcasts. I think that would be a really, really cool thing, because it would really kind of show that, you know, the two of them are different, but there's some points where they could not be any more alike. I really think that would be a cool thing to have between them. Would I introduce any new songs to it? Maybe one for Phoebus, where he's conflicted about why he, you know, is doing this and why he's, you know, listening to Frollo, something like that. But other than that, I'd focus maybe a little bit more on the story than on the music. Whereas Mulan failed and they did not have the songs in there, because honestly, I think that having a couple songs in there would make it more nice and more lively. I think it's going to be tougher to try to do that with The Hunchback of Notre Dame. You don't necessarily have to put all the songs in there, but enough to where you can at least have that same Disney feel that Disney knows how to create. All right, so here's where it's going to be another 50-50 deal, and I know that there's going to be people that are going to probably hate me for this, but at the same time, I don't care. This is my show. As far as the gargoyles go, I would keep them. However, main thing I would change about them is that I would not have three there. I would have two. And with those two, you would definitely have, you know, the one that's suggesting to do the right thing, and the one that's suggesting to do something that's not so right. Having that kind of deal would really make for more of a purpose for them to have that, because Quasimodo's been locked in the bell tower for a long time. Now he's just hallucinating about this, but it's also one of those things where they have a purpose to be there. They're kind of his inner voice, his inner conscience, helping him get through life. And here's something else that I would throw in. I would keep that scene where Quasimodo is locked up in the bell tower. He's in chains. He feels helpless. I would keep that, and I would still keep the whole deal where you know, the gargoyles are trying to help them, or seemingly try to help them. And I would have it be a situation where even though the two sides are different, at this one moment, they agree on something that, you know, Quasimodo giving up is not going to help. And that strong line that Jason Alexander, that all three of them have, where basically they say, they have the lines of, you know, okay, we'll leave you alone. After all, we're just made of stone. We thought that you would be built out of something stronger. Having that little like dialogue line in there, that would just be great. I think that would just be perfect to keep that. Now, where would I kind of stand on that? I would also, since the fact is that Pirates of the Caribbean have done this, and it's not going to be something that Disney hasn't done in the past, instead of, you know, having Esmeralda burned, I would have that deal end up with Esmeralda looking like she's about to be hanged. It's going to be a dark deal, yes, but at the same time, Pirates of the Caribbean got away with it, so why not Hunchback of Notre Dame? And are we going to kill off Esmeralda? No, that is not going to happen. But I definitely do want to keep that whole, you know, is she dead, isn't she dead kind of feel to it. And there is a way that you can make it work. Maybe it's a situation where Phoebus is able to get a knife or something that breaks the rope, and just as she's fallen down into the hole, Quasimodo grabs her and takes her away to sanctuary, stuff like that. There's a way to make it work. There really is. And to be honest, in the end, you could go one of two different ways. You could have the movie way, which is having Esmeralda and Phoebus together, because of the fact that maybe it's one of those things that seems more natural. Or you can have it be a different change, where you can have Quasimodo and Esmeralda end up together, because hopefully by that point they definitely have built that relationship between the two of them well enough to where Esmeralda can see herself being with Quasimodo, and Phoebus being one of those characters who's going to be a grand support. And you know, maybe his faith grows strong with this relationship. Maybe his faith gets tested, and maybe he ends up with I think it's like Melody, whoever the woman was in like Hunchback 2. Maybe they can build a story off of that. But honestly, it's not hard to do a remake. You just have to be smart about it. You can't just do copy and paste with things entirely. You do need to add those details of what can we do differently to make this story different from what it was in the past. Obviously, major success and something that a lot of people really liked was Pete's Dragon, because of the fact that at the original, it's a movie where the kid is basically running away from these abusive family members, and he's trying to find his home. And in the same aspect, the new Pete's Dragon is not having to deal with the abusive side of it, but it's just him losing his family and trying to find a new one, something like that. Just something that made, you know, just as equally an impact, even though I still think the original was better, especially at the end of the movie, where you had Elliot and, what's the kid's name? I forget. Where you have the dragon and the kid, they, you know, say their goodbyes because Elliot's purpose is, you know, now going on with another kid. Whereas in the end of the new one, he kind of just appears with a bunch of other dragons. It's like, what? Okay, that's no. I don't know. Maybe I need to rewatch that movie and give it a chance. I just think the original was the better one. Just, you know, you gotta find ways to not make it like stupid easy with some of these motivations. But if you can make them something that you could see somebody else, you know, having, that if you can make it more relatable, I guess you could say with it, where, you know, people have seen somebody who was, of course, you know, on the right path fall into another path and it corrupted them. That's easy for people to find. You see somebody who has had a hard life and you think that they're still going to stay in that lifestyle, but as time goes on, they're going to be going on to a different lifestyle and it's going to be a better one. It's not that hard to remake. You just have to really fine tune a lot of the things that you really need to look at. Like I said, you develop the great characters, you create an easy storyline to follow, don't make it too over the top, which, considering it's Hunchback of Notre Dame, might be a little bit easier said than done, but at the same time, it's one of those movies that could definitely really change the tide as far as Disney goes. But we'll have to wait and see. So those are my thoughts on the Hunchback of Notre Dame remake, what I think they could do better with, and what I would like to see coming out of it. But we'll just have to wait and see. Maybe when it comes out, I'll re-listen to what I had to say and re-evaluate if, you know, these are the things that I had in mind or if it was something else that I had in mind. So we'll have to wait and see. So thank you guys so much for listening in. This has been the Game Changer Podcast. You can always follow me on Twitter and on Instagram at RealFNGame. You can also check us out on multiple formats on the podcasting network, whether it's on iTunes, Spotify, iHeartRadio, so many great places, you guys, as well as enjoy many other episodes that I've done here, which has been interviews, talking about pop culture, talking about movies, talking about rewrites like this. Definitely let me know if there's a specific topic or some kind of discussion that you would like for me to cover, and I will look into it and I'll give my best feedback on it. So thank you guys so much. Feel free to leave a like and subscribe on the YouTube channel. And for everybody here at the Game Changer, I've been Nate the effing great. Just remember, guys, stay safe, be smart out there, and remember, you can make a difference by being a game changer one day at a time. Thank you guys so much. See you later. Bye-bye.
Beata Maria, you know I am a righteous man. Of my virtue I am justly proud. Beata Maria, you know I'm so much purer than the common, vulgar, weak, licentious crowd. Then tell me, Maria, why I see her dancing there, why her smoldering eyes still scorch my soul. I feel her, I see her, the sun caught in her raven hair is blazing in me out of all control. Like fire, hellfire, this fire in my skin, this burning desire is turning me to sin. It's not my fault, I'm not to blame. It is the gypsy girl, the witch who set this flame. It's not my fault, if in God's plan he made the devil so much stronger than a man. Protect me, Maria, don't let the siren cast her spell. Don't let her fire sear my flesh and bone. Destroy Esmeralda and let her taste the fires of hell, or else let her be mine and mine alone.
Minister Folon, the gypsy has escaped.
What?
She's nowhere in the cathedral. She's gone.
But how? Never mind. Get out, you idiot. I'll find her. I'll find her if I have to burn down all of Paris. Hellfire, dark fire, now gypsy, it's your turn. Choose me or your pyre, be mine or you will burn. God have mercy on her. God have mercy on me. But she will be mine.